These days, if you don't pay your taxes, you usually get a letter from the IRS, called in for an audit, and cough up the dough to satisfy Uncle Sam. If you don't have the cash, then they simply take everything you own, maybe throw you in prison or impose outrageous interest on what you owe, and basically ruin your life. I thought that's what ex-wives were supposed to do. Probably some people you don't want to mess with, but altogether they're just doing their job, which is pretty much instilling fear in people to pay their taxes. Kind of what these guys went through. But what happened to you in the historical times when you didn't pay the exorbitant tax the king or the emperor decided to impose on the people? Well, you can bet an IRS agent wouldn't show up at your door. More like something pretty bad could happen to you, such as in the earlier times when the government wasn't quite so mannered in its approach to convince you to pay your dues. Even Jesus had to pay taxes, quoting the famous phrase, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." Hey, the creator of the universe speaks, so let's listen. Taxes were handled differently in the times of Jesus. Instead of issuing payment to the IRS, you paid directly to a local tax collector, who arbitrarily decided what you're going to pay. Tax collectors did not receive a salary. They got their pay by charging people more than what they owed. These men routinely cheated citizens and didn't care how they felt about it. Just another day in the life of your friendly neighborhood tax collector. Throughout the mid-19th century, debtors' prisons were a common way to deal with unpaid debt in Western Europe. Destitute persons who were unable to pay a court-ordered judgment would be incarcerated in these prisons until they had worked off their debt via labor or secured outside funds to pay the balance. The product of their labor went towards both the cost of their incarceration and their accrued debt. Basically, cough up the cash or go to prison, which hasn't changed much up to this day. So here are a few examples of earlier times when you didn't pay your taxes. King James I. James I of Scotland and England was the definition of the poor little rich prince. Son of Mary, Queen of the Scots, James had essentially been orphaned as a baby when his father, Henry Stuart, Lord Darnley, was murdered and his mother imprisoned. He ruled over the warring cash-poor nation of Scotland from the age of one and inherited the throne of England in March 1603. James was overwhelmed with the riches he encountered in England and started spending like the absolute monarch he was. Hey, it's good to be the king. The spendthrift leader treated his subjects like a bank that was always open to fund his lavish lifestyles. The king excused his spending by saying he was like a poor man wandering about 40 years in a wilderness and barren soil and now arrived at the land of promise. Yeah, whatever helps you sleep at night. This abuse of the public purse enraged commoners and aristocrats alike, especially the king's use of forced loans. These loans were little more than a shakedown of landed gentry. Charles also hit merchants with exorbitant custom duties on goods that were not sanctioned by Parliament. This mismanagement led to 76 gentlemen being imprisoned for refusing to give the king money for his pet projects and wars. Tired of all the outrageous spending and taxes, the people rebelled, and in 1649, Charles was executed outside the banquet hall of the Palace of Whitehall. Taxes in Roman times. Whether you were male or female, rich or poor, Roman or barbarian, if you belonged to Rome, you had to pay taxes to Rome. In order to find those eligible for taxes and to collect all the various taxes, the Romans had the tax man. The tax man was called a publicanus, meaning public revenue. Publicans bid at the Roman Senate open auctions for the right to collect taxes for a certain city or area under Rome's rule. During the final death throes of the empire, Emperor Galerius imposed a higher capitation tax. Surveyors would arrive on a person's property and measure every spot of land, number all the vines and fruit trees, and make lists of all the animals and their kinds in order to tax the assets of the landowner. Slaves were beaten to extract information on hidden assets of their masters, wives were tortured to bear witness against their husbands, and sons were strapped to the rack to force them to reveal their father's assets. Imaginary assets, given under torture, were entered into the books and were taxed as real assets. The head tax was imposed on a sliding scale on everyone in the empire, including children and babies. The people were further outraged when the rulers levied a death tax, not only on those who had died, but also on their dead animals. It was said, "We cannot live or cease to live without being subject to taxes." When Galerius was confronted with mendicants who could not pay any tax, he caused them to assemble in groups, put them in boats, and sunk the boats because, as he said, he had compassion on them and did not want them to remain indigent. This draconian action also ensured that none, under the pretext of poverty, should elude the capitation tax. Ancient Egypt. The ancient Egyptians had extensive taxation regimes. However, the punishments for actual evasion were pretty brutal. Tax evaders were held down and caned repeatedly in public. The standard procedure, it seems, was 100 canings plus 5 sharp cuts for severe evasion situations. If you really went wrong, however, according to the historian Herodotus, the law from around 500 BC onwards dictated that you be put to death. Either you were burned or impaled, neither of which was helpful in giving you a body to enter the famously complex Egyptian afterlife. Medieval Islamic Middle East. Imprisonment for debt was also practiced in Islam, though not quite so extreme. Debtors who refused to pay their debts could be detained for several months in order to exert pressure on them. If they proved insolvent, they were released and placed under legal guardianship. Medieval Europe. The concept of imprisoning debtors really came into its own in medieval Europe, where debtors' prisons became the first established places in which imprisonment was levied as a punishment instead of a massive fine or mutilation. Instead, people who owed taxes to the state were put in filthy places either until they could pay off the debt or simply for a fixed period of time. The real issue with debtor's prison was that it was entirely down to the prisoner whether or not the stay was comfortable. Everything from bedding and firewood to luxuries had to be paid for by family and friends. Wealthy people could furnish their cells excellently and make themselves comfortable, but people without a penny to their name often contracted diseases or died while imprisoned. Both men and women were locked up together in a single large cell until their families paid their debt. Debt prisoners often died of diseases contracted from other debt prisoners, and conditions included starvation and abuse from other prisoners. If the father of a family was imprisoned for debt, the family business often suffered while the mother and children fell into poverty. Unable to pay the debt, the father often remained in debtor's prison for many years. The Tang Dynasty in China. The Tang Dynasty in China had an intensely regulated tax code based around the equal field system, in which they attempted to document the exact wealth, land, and tax obligations of every member of every household. Not an easy task when it comes to an empire of 50 million people. There were different categories of land given out to different ranks, and even the lowest-ranking peasants had to pay 2 shoulder loads of grain, 20 foot of silk or hemp, and 20 days of labor per year to the government. The fact that this was done on a family-by-family basis is important, because not only did they throw tax evaders in prison, but they made it a family affair. Sentences sometimes lasted years, and if the father of the family died in prison while serving out his sentence, his son was thrown in to live out the rest of it. Renaissance Italy. Renaissance Italians in the mid-1400s dealt with a very particular kind of tax evasion scheme, the kind that involves monks. People in this period had to pay high property taxes, so they tried to get around it with a device that will be familiar to modern-day tax dodgers. They arranged with a local monastery or abbey to declare that their property, house, or land had actually been given to the monks for their religious use. Religious institutions weren't taxed at that time. Results? A neat little loophole. The authorities dealt with it by bringing in a horde of lawyers who battled through red tape and slapped the monasteries with a fictional and fraudulent label that meant everybody had to pay up. But the paperwork frustrated everybody and led to a lot of annoyed lawyers. Imagine that. Early Edo period Japan. The pre-19th century Japanese were not kidding around when it came to their punishments. starting from around the Edo period, tax evaders were no longer flogged. Instead, they started having their ears removed. Mutilation was a fairly common type of punishment in that era. Removal of a single ear and/or the nose was given as the accepted response for everything from theft to illegal gamblers, and the hands and fingers of pickpockets were often cut off. If you were highly ranked, getting your ears mutilated could operate as an alternative to capital punishment. Ear removal could also be accompanied by having your face slashed and being ordered into exile, though typically it didn't involve another common punishment for other crimes in Edo Japan, a large facial tattoo. Either way, it makes an audit sound like a day at the beach. Compared to today's tax collection methods, we seem pretty lame, but regardless, no one wants the IRS coming after them. Taxes will always be around, so follow the age-old golden rule: pay your taxes. Until next time.